Everyone, how is everybody doing tonight? Welcome to Pyware Homeschool, our masterclass. Tonight we're bringing on Brantley Douglas. He's been a consultant with Pyware for, 20 plus years now?
A long time.
A long time. Brantley's been around the block once or twice with us, that's for sure. If you could just give a little brief synopsis of you.
Sure. I'm a proud native of New Jersey, now living in Arkansas. Been involved in marching, I'm going to say since 1970, as a performer in high school and junior high, marched with a local drum corps, just been involved in the marching arts from, like I said, the mid 70s till now. Done everything from a performer to an adjudicator to a designer to a disgruntled fan. So, run the whole spectrum there.
Wonderful. Well, Brantley's going to be talking about designing for small bands tonight. So, what can you tell us? How can we make our small bands better?
Well, I'll tell you what I've got, Destin, and feel free to stop me because it's a little bit wordy and those sorts of things. But I made a PowerPoint presentation to sort of talk about things that you need to look for with small bands, not just from a design standpoint, but from a musical standpoint and the analysis process that you need to do to prepare to create an entertaining, educational, competitive type show.
Wonderful.
Okay, so I'm just going to start this PowerPoint, and if at any time you feel it's like too much, just say stop, and we can move on to something else.
All right.
Okay. All right.
We'll interject any questions that come along as well. So.
Sure. Okay. So forgive my. This is all new for me here, so I'm going to be sharing this, and hopefully you'll all be able to see this. Does everybody see that?
We have a PowerPoint.
Okay, small marching band, what to consider when planning a show. And here are some of the things that you need to think about. There are several things to keep in mind when planning a show for a small band. We're going to define a small band for our purposes of 35 or fewer members, including any auxiliary units, percussion, wind players, and drum majors. I think that would be acceptable for a small band.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Here are the items that I would like to discuss. We'll be talking about educational goals, your student and staff experience, music considerations, and preparing to design for your group. Okay. Right. Educational goals and outcomes. The thing that I think we need to remember, whether you're a big band or a small band, right? Remember the educational goals and outcomes for your students and your program. You know, we don't do marching band just to go out there to win the trophies. We hope that, hopefully, as educators, that our students will come out stronger as musician and visual performers. So making sure that you do have those educational goals. I always say that what you do with your indoor band, as far as tone production, making music, are exactly the same things you need to do with your outdoor band. So to make sure that those skills are transferable. Okay, oops, come on, right? And to do that, you need to have clearly defined musical and visual goals, right? Whether it's the style of music that you're using, the style of marching that you're using, you want to make sure those are clearly defined, and those are things that come in your lesson plans, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, okay? You want to make sure that you develop a basics program based on the goals identified. I.e. your warm-up. So if you're talking about a particular style that you're doing, if it's Latin or jazz or classical or whatever, to make sure that you include those types of musical exercises in your warm-up program, and any sort of interesting or different visual aspects, to make sure that's included in your marching block as well, right? And to make that a part of your regular warm-up sequence, right? Here's something that small bands tend to forget. Small bands, big bands. I'm going to say this is for bands in general. Be certain that all sections have a warm-up sequence or routine that emphasizes your educational goals. And what do I mean by that? I mean that your percussion section, your auxiliary units, your wind players all need to have those sequences designed for them, because in the long run will save you time, will improve the skill level of your students as well. And this is something to consider as well. As skills are mastered, continue to evaluate your basics program to aid in the development of your students. Let's say they mastered staccato marcato. You can move on to shaping phrases and so on and so forth. So not to let your basics program get stagnant. You know, once you feel that something has been mastered, go on to the next level, so that way you can keep keep developing them as students.
Based on your experience, how often is that reevaluated and actually changed?
It depends upon the group. We always used to joke, like, what was in the water the year, you know, whatever these kids are. And sometimes things go faster, you know, and it's like, okay, we've got this now, let's move on to the next step. Or sometimes it's just like, oh my gosh, this is going to be a battle till the end of the season. You know, it just depends upon the group, the year. You know, I think we're going to be in for something new this fall, you know, again, with the situation that everybody's in right now. People that have early band camps will probably be delayed. So, you know, I think this season is going to be a very, very interesting one from that standpoint, to see how people are going to deal with this, with their basics program, right, getting things started, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, I wish I could tell you what's going to happen, especially now that, you know, the DCI season has been canceled this year. And, like I said, who knows if band camps are going to be delayed or what. I'm kind of worried about my camp, because we go in usually the second week of August. And, we just don't have to wait and see at this point.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, after we get done with this, would you be able to upload that PowerPoint as well?
The handout that I have pretty much has all this information in it.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
I will tell you, the second half is not in there, but I'll be able to upload that PowerPoint for you.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Here's something that you need to do in this sort of pre-planning process. You need to make an accurate evaluation of your student and staff abilities and experience, right? And this is something to remember. Often with smaller bands, the membership will have a larger percentage of younger or first-time marchers. I know that there are many schools, well, I shouldn't say many schools, but there are many small bands where they'll march some of their middle school kids, and that'll be like their first experience with marching band. If at all possible, try to have earlier teaching time with these students before your regular band camp, just to get them acclimated with things that they just don't know about marching band, right? Because if you can spend time with them taking care of those things, simple things like this is where we store the instruments, this is sort of our procedure, this is what we do, by sharing those things with them, so they're not feeling like total outsiders in this new event that they're involved with. Okay, let's move on to the music considerations, right? With a small band, you need to check your instrumentation and make adjustments to parts as needed to create a proper balance. Like any music ensemble, we think about that pyramid formation and the sound with the bass voices going up to the soprano voices, with the basses being the base of the pyramid. So make sure that you think about making any adjustments to like any arrangements, whether you're using stock arrangements or custom arrangements, to make sure that you know what that instrumentation is, especially with your ensemble. And unfortunately with small bands, you know, your instrument expectation could change from year to year, month to month, day to day, you know. So to make sure that, you know, you make adjustments as needed, right? And in that, always be aware of the melodic line and who has it, to see if that needs to be reinforced with another line or maybe someone that isn't playing at that time. But when we think about the structure of melody, harmony, et cetera, make sure that that melodic line is present, right? If the traditional four voices, soprano, alto, tenor, and bass, are not available, consider using three voices and thinking about them as the high voices, your flutes, piccolos, clarinets, trumpets, your middle voices, your mellophones, alto saxophones, and then your low voices, your low brass, your low winds, if you can't have the traditional four parts. Go ahead and do that because, you know, you're responsible for the sound of your band, the balance. So do what you need to do to make sure those things happen. Gosh, this is boring. Okay. General music consideration.
Before you move on.
Yeah.
What would you suggest for blending those, the four voices into the three? Is there anything that you can suggest?
Well, yeah. Because when we usually look at the soprano, alto, tenor, bass scenario, right, is that usually that we start talking about maybe some split parts between some of the middle voices, like the, I'm going to say between like the alto and tenor parts. Sometimes there will be splits in the alto parts. There could be splits in the mellophone parts. There could be splits in the trombone parts, i.e. having trombone one, trombone two. I would look at like combining those things so that maybe you would take your alto and tenor voices, and of course making sure that they're octave appropriate, and making that your middle voice, you know, and then keeping right. Your high voices, your sopranos, your flutes, your clarinets, your trumpets in the high range, using your altos, trombones for the middle range. You can use baritone, tenor sax, your tubas for the low range.
Wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. I've unfortunately seen this too many times. Please be smart in your music selection, all right? It is not a good idea to play the 1812 overture with 12 wind players, okay? You probably do not want to play pictures at an exhibition, the Great Gate of Kiev, with 8 wind players, all right? I say it in jest, but let me tell you, I have seen things like that. I'm thinking, you've got 10 people out there and you're trying to play the Rite of Spring. It's not working, all right? So be smart in your music selection. You know, just because Santa Clara or Blue Devils or Blue Coats did this with their 150 folks, all right, and their 72 trained brass players and percussionists, you know, if you've got 16 winds, don't do it. It will not be the same thing. I'm just telling you that, okay? And, you know, and you know, it's not to say that we can't stretch our students and to look for quality literature. And by all means, I want you to do quality literature, but find the literature that is going to be appropriate for the size of your ensemble.
Would you be able to suggest any composers for small bands?
I know that, there's Key Poulin does good stuff. Robert W. Smith does good stuff for small bands. I know that you can go to Arrangers Publishing. Who is it? Jay Dawson. And what's interesting about Arrangers Publishers, and they're not the only ones that do this, is that they do have a section of scoring for smaller bands with limited instrumentation. So you need to look for those. And, you know, if you go to a company like Marching Show Concepts, you know, they have various levels of like the same shows. They'll have it for like the big band, and then they'll have a band, as they say, with limited instrumentation. So, I mean, you can look around, you can find those stock arrangements. If you're fortunate enough to have an arranger, you know, you need to be very honest with them and say, this is what we have and this is what we need to do.
Right.
One of the things that, and I don't know if I really talk about this, but, you know, is that when you get a stock arrangement, you can look at things that you need to do. Let's say if you need to play something in a different octave, you know, I mean, you could even consider changing the key if you need to. I mean, you need to do what you need to do to make your band sound good.
Right.
Yeah.
Thanks, sir.
Okay. So, here are some things to talk about percussion. If you have a small percussion section, consider not having them march and create an outdoor percussion ensemble. If you do this, consider their placement on the field. They don't necessarily have to be in the front. And again, it all depends upon the number of wind players that you have. The idea of placing them on the field so that they can play through the wind players is something to think about as well. Also, the idea of using your percussion section, if you have, like I said, a small percussion section, this will allow each individual to create more timbres within the band, i.e. they'll be able to play more than one instrument. That, you know, you could literally have, if you had three percussionists, you know, they could all be multi-percussionists, you know, instead of having three percussion sounds, you can have 9, 10, a dozen. Different percussion sounds, which will make things more interesting. So definitely consider that. And again, consider their placement on the field as well. And if you have the ability to have an electronic keyboard, that can help fill in so many of the gaps in your instrumentation, right? And the key there is to make sure that you find a sound that will blend, and also to make sure that you check to make sure that it doesn't overbalance.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Let's talk about designing your show. And designing your show for a small band is no different in my mind than designing a show for a medium size or a large band. All right. Okay. You need to storyboard your show. Now, again, we're talking about a competitive band show. I mean, if you're a Friday night football band and you do a different show every week, well, that's, you know, a different matter. But if you're looking like to do a competitive show, go ahead and storyboard your show. And what does that mean? That means that when you have your ideas, that you're sort of brainstorming, getting everything out, all the impossible things, all right? Because at this stage, everything is possible, right? Once you're looking at that. And with that, with this whole storyboarding idea, it'll give you an idea of the flow of your show, and you should be able to look at that to say, well, is this more than we've done in the past, or is this less than we've done in the past? Is this a spot where we need to step up, and so on and so forth? Also, with the storyboarding of your show, that will allow you to make sure that you're looking for variety as well within your production, making sure that you have those impact moments, at least one effect moment, they say every 40 to 60 seconds within your program. So by storyboarding your show, even for your small 20-piece band, will make that more entertaining, more competitive. And also, you want to make sure that you share this information with your students so that they have an understanding of what their responsibilities are from a musical standpoint and a visual standpoint, and then a storytelling standpoint as well.
When you say an effect moment every 40 to 60 seconds, what would you suggest? Is it a visual impact, a musical impact, or a combination thereof, or
all of the above, in any combination? You know, when we talk about effect, effect doesn't have to be a slam, bam, throwing babies moment, as I call it, in your show. An effect can be something that can be very subtle, very something that evokes some sort of response, whether it's, like I said, a throwing baby moment, or if it's that moment where you just go, oh, that was nice.
Right. You know,
right. So to make sure that you're looking for those, and to make sure that you do have a variety of those types of things as well.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Well, thank you, sir.
Okay. Use a music visual worksheet, and I'll show what that is just a little bit later. And that's where you sort of get down to the nitty-gritty of things, because then you're making sure that you're seeing what you're hearing and you're hearing what you're seeing, right? This will also help you in the planning of making sure that people are in the right spot at the right time by doing this musical visual worksheet. And we'll talk more about that a little bit later if there are questions about that. I think the most important thing that a small band needs to do, and that is to control your performance space. And what do I mean by that? I mean that, you know, when you think about your performance space is a football field, right? You've got 100 yards. That's a lot of space if you've got 20 people, right? So doing whatever you can to control your performance space, bounding the area that you're going to use with props. You know, I'm not one to have props for props' sake, but you know, if you're a smaller band and you want to be focused in one area, having some sort of backdrop, you can control your space, and then that way it doesn't look like you're on the entire field. Okay, whether you can use panels, columns, you could use a floor mat to make that your performance space. But just to think about making sure that's something that you can control. So make sure you take advantage of that when you can, right? generally, if you're a small band, try not to go behind the front hash mark, the home hash, just that things get like really lost once you start getting to like midfield and further back. So those are just some things. Some other things, generally try to stay between the 30-yard line. Oops, what was that? Well, maybe I heard my echo.
If you're saying stay behind or in front of the front side or front hash, right. If you're mm-hmm. using back panel props, would you mm-hmm. suggest maybe pushing that a little bit further? Where would you station those props?
You know, and again, it depends upon how you're using the props. If the props are going to be stationary, or they're going to be movable, et cetera, et cetera. That's something that has to be taken into consideration as well. But I would say that if you're going, according to my rule, and of course for every rule, there are exceptions in marching band,
right.
That you're going to be between the front sideline and the back hash. Maybe you want to have your props, if you're going to use them, if you're using them just like a pure backdrop, right, just to confine your space, you know, put them 4-6 steps behind the hash mark, right, just so that'll give you a little space, not unless there's something that, you know, where they have to go right up and interact with the prop per se, you know, or if it's a type of thing where they're going to be going behind the prop for whatever reason, you know, then, you know, you don't want to have them so far back that they're like out of the picture as they go back behind the prop and then come back out again.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Again, try to stay between the 30-yard lines from side A to side B, left to right. When the wind players are moving, try to use a 2 or 3 step distance while the winds are playing. And the reason I suggest that is because if you start spreading out further than that while they are playing, you're going to lose that cohesiveness in the sound. And again, it depends upon the formation. If they're strung out in a long curvilinear sort of thing, it's going to make it hard to blend the sound as opposed if they're stacked up. So generally, I say use a 2 or 3 distance while the winds are playing. Now, when they aren't playing, using a 4-6 step interval is fine, okay? I'm suggesting using a windowed block for static impact points. And I'll show a demonstration of what a window block is if you're not sure. You know, when we think about a block formation, if we have 16 people, 4 by 4 by 4, 4 by 4, four across, four behind, that you don't want them necessarily, if it's a big musical moment, standing directly behind one another, but staggering every other line so that they're in the windows of the person in front of them, so they're not playing directly in the back of the head of the person in front of them. Okay. And here's something.
Jump over and show an example of that.
What's that? Do you want me to show an example now?
Jump over and show. Please, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I can do that, I think. Okay, I'm going to hide this. If I do something crazy, I'm sorry. Okay. Change sharing window.
That's what I'm doing.
Going to go to the application window. Going to go to my Pyware. Going to go to share. And what I've done is that I've sort of created this scenario with props. And you can see from this demonstration how we're focused now between the 30-yard line and the back hash, pretty much. And you see there's all that other space there. You know, imagine that if those props weren't there, you would have that whole visual space to look at. And what's really interesting is when we look at the real view. Oops.
You don't have to do a whole screen share if it doesn't show up.
There we go. Right. So you can see that even when I go to, let's say, like the stadium view, okay.
You'll need to swap the screen over. We don't have the real view currently.
Oh.
Do share screen and then share whole screen.
Okay. Let me do that. Okay. Okay. I'm going to
change
sharing window. Going to application window.
No, just the share whole screen.
Okay, sorry. All right, let me try this again. Ah.
There we go, and then share whole screen.
Okay, view your entire screen.
That's it.
Okay. Okay, is it showing?
Yes. Go ahead and pop over to 3D now.
Okay, can you see it?
You need to just pull 3D to the front. We can see your screen now.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
There we go.
Ta-da! Okay, so you can see everything now.
We can see everything now.
Okay, can you see me?
We can see you.
Oh, shoot, I can't pick my nose then. All right, okay, all right. So, all right, so here you can see the difference when we see that there's that targeted area. You know, if you're in a big stadium, now all of a sudden we're focused into that area. That's why I think if you're a small band, that's almost a requirement, you know. And one of the things that I would like to mention is that if you do have to do this, right, do what you can within your budget to make sure that your props are professional looking, all right? And what do I mean by that? Not a refrigerator cardboard box and crayon drawings, all right? Okay, and I say that with a little bit of a smile, but I have seen some things like that, right? You wanna make sure that's gonna be professional and well presented as well, because it's going to be just a general reflection on your ensemble. So, you know, do what you can do. There are companies out there that'll do these for you with custom designs or whatever, you know. And if you know, it could be the type of thing where you just do something like a black screen flat. That's something that you can use from year to year. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be show specific. So
wonderful.
But the windowed block, yeah. Okay. And so what I did here is it said I sort of hid the performers. So let me show them.
Okay.
Okay, show all. Okay. So there's our performers, all right, okay? Mm-hmm. Right. And you see right now they're in a block formation and they're sort of, and this would be an opening set. So this would be the opening set. But when I talk about a windowed block, is what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to take this line and this line here, right? I'm just going to shift them over two steps, and you'll see the difference that that makes. By doing that, right? So when we look at that, again, it gives us a little bit of texture, and it gives us the a little bit more of a full feeling within this. And that's what I mean by a window, is that this person is standing in the window of the person in front of them. So for a small band, you know, especially if you're doing a big musical impact point, and you're in a block formation, to definitely look at trying to do a windowed block as opposed to a non-windowed block.
Wonderful. It makes your smaller group look a little bit larger.
It does. It does. It fills up some of the negative space between those vertical lines. And interestingly, a good way to hide folks is to have that solid vertical alignment behind one another if you need to be smaller in your smaller band.
Collapse the visual effect quickly.
Right. You know, but it could be that type of thing. It's like, oh, they're there, oh, they're not there. Oh, they're there, oh, they're not there, sort of type of thing, right. You know, if you need to do something like that.
Okay. Well, thank you, sir.
Okay. All right.
For clarification.
Okay. I'm going to hide this.
Go for it.
And I'm going to try to get back to the PowerPoint. And I can jump back and forth as we go through this, too, if that works.
Okay. That works. Thank you, sir.
Okay. All right. Oh, and the last point on this, I was asking folks to consider, body movements instead of drill sets. You know, I remember writing for a small band, and I said, well, how many sets are you used to doing? He says, oh, just write. You just do whatever you want. I'm like, are you sure? All right, okay, I'll do this. And, you know, I did this, and I thought, man, this is great. I'm loving this. This is great. You know, oh, man, this is going to be so cool. He said his band could do anything. I sent him the drill. I think there were like 32 pages in the opener. He's like, we do 32 pages in our whole show. That's just the opener. Well, you told me, you know, that's what you could do. So the idea of, you know, because when we think about marching band, the whole thing is not necessarily the pictures that you make, but it's how you get from point A to point B. It's a transition, you know, and there are times where you just can't be moving all the time. And let's say you have a 64, a 72, 128 count hold. One of the things that I'm suggesting is that to look at doing different body gestures within that, so then that way there's not necessarily the constant movement, but you're filling up those static moments with something visual.
Wonderful. So instead of doing a drill move, you're going to have multiple visual body movements.
Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And the upside to that is that that's less drill that you have to teach, but it's still choreography or whatever movement that you will have to teach and clean, but that could be easier than trying to teach the drill sets and those longer static moments.
Understandable.
Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. Let's see what else is coming up here. Okay. Right? This is the thing where I'm talking about analyzing the music, because doing a proper analysis of the music will help you to determine what should happen visually.
Okay.
Right? The analysis, okay, and this is coming straight from my marching band procedures class. So if any of my students are out there, they're like, oh, we've seen this before. The analysis of the music is the foundation of the drill, okay? A written outline or summary of the music should be made, must be made. Using a visual musical worksheet will assist in the process of designing your show. This is completed by determining the musical phrases and determining the type of music, a movement, if any, will take place. This process will also allow the designer to plan for various segments of the ensemble that needs to be featured. And the great thing about doing this, and this is all the homework that you do even before you start putting a form on the screen, is that this will allow you to see where segments are supposed to be featured or a voicing is supposed to be featured. And then that way you can start planning. My general rule is this next one. A good rule is to plan at least 3 pages before a desired effect to make sure all the elements are in the proper place. The visual musical worksheet will help in this process. So if you go through this and you know that on page 17, you've got to have your 3 clarinets up front, you know that you've got 3 pages now, you can look and say, oh, okay, this is where I need to start to make sure that this process happens. Or this is where, you know, the percussion section needs to come forward, all right? So by doing this, this will allow you to do that planning and to help to put that jigsaw puzzle together, right? In some ways, I think it's a little bit easier with a smaller band than it is with a larger band, because if you're talking 16, 20 wins, if you have that many wins, right, that it's usually easier to plan that. And sometimes you don't need the 3 pages, but you need to start thinking about it to make sure that that's happening.
A couple of real quick questions. Do you happen to have the visual worksheet that you might be able to share that you
get? Well, look what we have here.
There we go. And the secondary thing is the worksheet and whatnot. Would you suggest transferring that directly into the production sheet?
And that is the next thing that I was going to say, is that, you know, and you can do that. And I've done this a couple times, and I probably need to do this more. And I'm not sure why I don't do that, because I know there's that template in the program where it's an Excel spreadsheet, and you can just use that and type all that information in there, import it, and it's right there, so you don't have to do it twice. The reason I kind of like to do it like this is because if you look at mine, and this is, I don't know where I got this from. I you know, everything old is new again. but this is just the one that I've used, and you'll see that it has the measure, right, the counts. Here we put in the musical property or the form. It's in an introduction, verse, repeat, whatever. Where it says development, emotion, portrayed, this is where I tell people, like, use adjectives. It's happy, it's sad, it's fast, it's exciting, you know, all those types of things. But then what I like about this is that notes, instrumentation for the guard. If there's a particular form that I'm thinking about, I might sketch out that form, that sort of thing. The instrumentation, I usually put in like who's the most important person, or what voice is the most important at that point, whatever. And the reason that I like to do this is because, like I said, if I need to draw like a little sketch of something, I can put it in there and say, oh yeah, this is where we've got to be in a star formation or whatever. And so then I can look at that and say, okay, the star is there, but I've got to start planning for it like 3 pages ahead to make sure that everybody's in the right spot.
Wonderful.
And I will do this. Like I said, this is an example. I can add that as a handout as well.
Perfect. Thank you. Yeah, any and all of these are being requested as handouts as well. So it'd be great to have them shared.
Okay. Great.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So listening and studying the score, right? Listen to recordings, if available, while studying the score, right? And I tell directors this, if a recording isn't available, and I guess this is showing the old fuddy-duddy that I am. I said, make a MIDI recording. I said that to my class this year, and they're like, what's a MIDI recording? I thought, wow, I am so old. I said, make a garage band recording, like, oh yeah, okay, yeah, well, we can do that, okay. So maybe I need to change that to make a digital recording somehow, you know. And one of the things that's good for that, if you're fortunate, you know, that if you're a small band, and if a recording isn't available and you're able to make a digital or a MIDI recording, you know, that's something that you'll be able to send to, if you're fortunate enough to have somebody to write your percussion parts to them, if you're fortunate enough to have someone that does your guard routines, that you can send it to them so that they can start their process as well. Okay. You want to make sure that you listen, find and mark the following musical characteristics: that melodic line, look for dynamics, tempos, key changes, tempo changes, stylistic changes, because these are generally the things that will generate the visual aspects of what's happening. Right? Okay.
All righty.
Okay. This is just a general thing. Each phrase of the music should be analyzed. You as a designer must follow the music and design what is trying to be expressed. This is your job, right? The more complex the music, generally the easier it is to design. Complex music compositions contain more musical ideas which can reveal visual movement and staging. The challenges with less complex music is to create a visual package that is creative in ways to make up for the less creative composition. And I'm going to talk about those things in the next section.
Okay.
Right? movement and transition. And this is what I said earlier. Formations are only seen for a moment or when the movement becomes static and not moving, right? Movement is what we see the most, watching the performers move from one point to the next. I know this is all very basic, but this is something that, you know, we need to think about. As a designer, you should consider a balance of simple and complex movements and transitions, right? And this is possible for small bands. I think one of the things that I see with a lot of small bands that aren't successful is that they aren't considering this, and that there's the same type of movement constantly when they have the ability to do more, right? Simple movements, transitions tend to be singular. Complex movements, transitions tend to involve two or more types of movement. And I'm going to talk about those. Okay. Types of movement: reshaping, taking a line, going to an arc, floating, moving from one set to moving one form across, follow the leader, FTL, obviously following the leader, expansion, expanding a form, contracting a form, rotating a form, right? A general rule, and like I said, every rule can be broken, but a general rule is to try not to use the same type of movement more than two or three times consecutively. So you don't want to constantly be reshaping without maybe throwing in a float or some sort of rotation or follow the leader. So to sort of break things up, again, if you find yourself doing the same thing over and over again, look to see if there's something else that you can do. Are we good?
Good.
Okay. studying the musical phrases. The music should guide you as a designer to the direction and type of movement needed. You need to ask the following general questions when analyzing the phrases of your music. Always, what instruments have the melody? Okay, because you need to make sure that the melody is heard, right? Which performers need to be facing the press box? Does the music suggest a strong direction of motion? Basic rule, keep the movement predictable. So if you've got everybody lined up and they're coming forward, that's probably going to be a power moment in your production, right? You make the line, you expect them to come forward, you want to keep it predictable. And again, these are all just basic guidelines,
right?
Mm-hmm. Is the music developing an impact? Is the music suggesting expanding field coverage or contracting a form? Who or what is being featured in the transition? What direction should they be facing for the development? Basic rule, movement can be more complex and layered. So maybe a lot of activity before that moment happens.
Right.
Okay. I'm almost done. Is the music soft and flowing? Again, who has the melody? Are there soloists, musical or visual performers? You can have a visual soloist. Is there the possibility of facing different directions? Basic rule, move melodic soloist towards the audience generally or in a static position. Is the music repetitious? Where's the pulse center? What voices or elements are driving the repetition? Basic rule, movement could change direction, movement in contrary motion, movement that is complex or layered. And again, this I will send you all this. Movement transitions. this type of movement transition works well for bands with limited experience. These are generally the easiest to design and provide a solid foundation for developing marching bands. We'll see some of those. These are also used with more experienced bands singularly or in combination. And so when we talk about the single movement transition, we're talking about the reshape, the float, the follow the leader, expansion of a form, contraction of a form. Right. So those are the things that you should be looking at when designing for a less experienced band. Complex movement transitions, combining two or more of the previous movements transitions. This can create more variety in a way that a form can develop. One part of the form can be doing a different type of transition at the same time, but they complement each other. Some examples are reshaping and floating, float and follow the leader, reshape, expand, float, contract, follow the leader, rotate. I mean, you just find those combinations. So the idea of combining these singular events to make a more complex set of movement that you can do that.
Right.
Okay. And I think that's it.
Could you show us a couple of the examples in the software that you're
sure.
I've describing got for visual impacts?
Yes.
For the small bands?
Mm-hmm. Okay, here I'm going to share my screen again. And I guess I'll do the entire screen again, right?
If you're wanting to show the real view, yes. If you're just doing the design area, then we can just show the 3D.
I'll do the entire screen.
Okay.
And let me get this back out. Yeah. Right. So what I did was this, I just took this this set with just like 16 folks, and I showed you the difference already between the layered block. So this first transition isn't going to be the greatest because, well, you'll see why. but here's like our first set where they go from that position into an arc, right? You see that I have guard members, and you know what I'll do? I'll zoom in a little bit so we can see a little bit better.
Okay.
What's happening? And let me enlarge the screen as well. Is that better? Get a yes. Better view? Okay. I didn't label all the musicians yet, but we'll assume that these are wind players. I've got a front ensemble in the back there, right? And then there's going to be a little bit of a jump here in this animation because I didn't.
Because we adjusted the
right, block. Right. But essentially what I did was, is I did what was known as an accordion transition. And I'll explain the way that works. Oops, not supposed to see that yet. Okay. if you remember that these were in lines, right? The reason I call this an accordion transition because it unfolds like an accordion. Let me show you. So if you imagine that these are lines that were grouped, like this. That's the way they were. Does that make sense? From the original set. And so when I talk about an accordion, that it's sort of the matching order is, oops, didn't mean to draw that, is if you follow my cursor, can you see my cursor?
Yes.
Right, so it looks like an M so that the people are connected from the bottom, up, over, down, so that when they move, that it unfolds like an accordion. Hopefully everybody knows right. What an accordion is, right? Right. So
spread them between one and two.
Yeah.
Spread those anchors. There we go. Great. Now, we had a question pop up here. Deidre has a first-year marching band, and she doesn't want to overwhelm them. How many moves per piece might you suggest?
Well,
she's got many colors in there, so.
Right. I think it depends on the length of the piece, right? Mm-hmm. What I tend to do is that I try not to have, for like a young band, mm-hmm. I try not to have a lot of consecutive moves in a row.
Okay.
So it may be move 16, hold 24, move 16. And then again, it just depends upon the music, but I generally try not to have consecutive moves. It's usually do a move, hold, do a move, hold. Maybe for the end, I might put two moves together.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, and to make sure that you find those logical places for them to move on their musical phrases. You don't want to necessarily move in the middle of a phrase.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Deidre, does that answer your question?
It's hard to say. You know, it depends upon the length of a tune, you know. If it's like a 2-minute piece, again, depending upon how many phrases, you know, maybe you might have 5-6 moves, maybe,
mm-hmm.
maybe. And that's, again, sort of alternating between move, hold, or hold, move, hold, move.
Right. And then in those holds, you can add in more body visuals to.
Exactly. And here's the nice thing about that. Is that when you talk about adding body visuals, you know, you can have them all in mind. You know, I you know, even at UCA, you know, I will have some kids like, who can help me here with a visual? And like, oh yeah, we can do this, blah, 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 blah. And then it's a matter of like, okay, you've got to make sure that you break this down so that every count we know what's happening, you know. Mm-hmm. So and that allows for like student participation as well in the creative process.
That gives them a little bit of ownership over the show. So
exactly. When I was a grad student at Michigan, one of the things is that during the course of the season, the Michigan band would always feature a dance somewhere where they put their instruments down and they would dance, right? And there was an actual dance committee, and man, people fought to get on that dance committee.
That'd be a fun one.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you, sir.
So the next thing that I wanted to show, and again, Destin's told me that I'm an old fart and I was doing things the old way, because the clients that where I teach at UCA, we don't use props in our show yet. And the clients that I write for, I generally just use these sort of flat panel props that I've used for this demonstration, and I've used the prop tool to create those. But Dustin will talk about the much better way by using the visual editor to create your props so that you can, like, if there are props that you need to be on top of, that you can do that, and so on and so forth. But one of the things that I wanted to do is, again, to show the relationship of how the props, again, how that has sort of created that space for us where, and so this next maneuver that we have, we'll see that the props actually move to create a sort of different look, but still keeps the eye focused in on what's happening. So let's watch this transition here, all right?
So I'm moving your backdrops.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Pulling everybody to a company front.
Right, right, exactly. Well, let me do that again, right? And see, and with that, one of the things that you'll notice is that even to create a sort of sense of depth, I've even changed the size of the props, that they're sort of layered, mm-hmm. they're tiered in their sizes as well, to help to sort of create that effect of giving a little more actually depth to the band there, right? And here what's happening is that we're having complementary forms between the props and the wind and the color guard as well. And that's just a simple reshape right there. The next thing that I wanted to do was to create an idea of creating some dimension. And one of the things that, and Dustin, I don't know if a lot of people do this, but I think it is a godsend, using copy and paste.
Copy and paste is pretty magical.
Yes, yes. And, you know, it's amazing when I show people that, they're like, you have got to be kidding me. It's that easy to do that. And I say to think of your drill as sort of like a word processing document, that if there's like a word you wanted to replace, that you can do that with this program. And so with this maneuver is that we went from the company front into these diagonals. And instead of me doing it literally like four times, I just did it once and then just did a copy and paste. That's one way to do it. Of course, you can, well, there are many ways that you can do it, but I wanted to do it this way to show the example of copy and paste.
Right.
So let's look to see what this transition looks like here, right? And so we see the guard going around and then going through those spaces, those alleyways that are created by the wind players. All right. So that's what we're doing. And by the way, I used a tracking tool to do the guard to get them through there. And I'll show that too. What's that?
The track tool you used? Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. To do that. But let's talk about copy and paste, because I think that's something. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these three lines right here. Right. And I'm just going to go ahead and delete their transition right now.
Okay.
Okay. Right. So they're back to where they were. So I took this first line here, right? All right. I did what I had to do. I think I went ahead and like made these into like segments of four using the apply pattern.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So the thing is that I did this line, right? So what I can do is I can do my keyboard command of Command C. And by the way, I'm a certified Macaholic. So for your PC users, I'm sorry, you have to figure out what your commands are. but for me, it's Command C, which is copy, right? It's also here on the edit menu here. So for you PC users, it'll be there, whatever your command is right there. But so I have the form selected, right? And I'm copying, and what I'm copying is I'm copying those positions. So now I'll click on the next group right here, and I'm going to use Command V for paste, right? And you'll see that it's taken that, and I'll just use, I call this a bullseye arrow, bullseye, right? I'll click and drag that, and you know, I always check the animation to make sure I've got the right people, to make sure I don't need to flip-flop, right? And there they are. They're doing what they need to do.
Awesome.
Right? I click paste, right? And then it's still in memory. I click on the next segment, Command V, drag this over to where it needs to be. Paste. And the same thing.
If you wanted to get rowdy, you could copy the two.
That's true. That's true. You're absolutely correct with that. Paste. Now, with a small band, you know, that's a real nice feature. You can imagine if you've got a whole bunch of people, you know, and again, the idea of like taking two and then maybe four and then doing that way, and that's just a quick way so you don't have to keep drawing the same thing over and over again. You know, right. And people are like, you can do that? I'm like, oh, yeah, it's really nice.
That's right. Awesome.
So that's something to think about doing as well. Let's see. Okay. What did I do for this last one? Oh, yeah. And for this last set, let's see what happens here. Okay. I don't know why that's doing that. Because I...
Inverting our slants.
Yeah. Right. The jump in the animation because I didn't change it. Or I did change it.
And let me point out a little feature. Just go ahead and select all those people. So I go ahead and stop animation, select all those people.
Right, and do the copy.
No, all right. So go to edit. As a new in version 10 and rebuild continuity.
Oh my goodness.
And now animate it.
Oh wow. Yes. No way. Uh-oh.
Well, that should do it anyways. Did it not? Or is the jump before it?
Or maybe I need to do it here first. Mm-hmm. Rebuild continuity. Mm-hmm. And then here.
And let's play it all the way through there. Oh, jumped on the screen. There we go.
Yeah. Okay, what's happening there? That's interesting because in the past I've just done the copy and paste.
You can copy and paste, or you can actually also morph and accept. All of the above.
Mm-hmm. I'll have to play with that.
There we go.
Because typically I would do copy, paste,
accept.
Make sure that we're going in the right direction. See if that. Yeah. I'll have to play with that. I haven't noticed that, so.
We had a couple of questions pop up here. The props have different location on the grid than they do in the real view. That is because they are standard props, and he is doing them as a vertical panel. And if you stretch the image to be shown vertically on the design view, it centers the vertical panel inside that box. With the standard props, you can adjust that. On the performer props, it locks the vertical panels into a line, so it will isolate only the footprint when it's shown. And that's the difference between a standard prop and a performer prop.
Right. And I was going to say, the other thing is that you'll notice that all the props are the same size on the designer screen, but on the 3D screen, that they're all different. Right, and that's because
you've defined the height in the props tool.
Exactly right. So when I click on the prop,
you do it on count zero.
Yes, thank you.
And that's one difference as well, is you can only modify the sizes of those of the standard props on count zero. Whereas in the performer props function, you can actually adjust the size on the fly.
Okay.
So if you have a prop that might be changing sizes, or maybe it might be like a sheer piece of fabric or something of that nature,
you
can adjust that on the fly and see the visual effect.
Okay. Because I was going to say that, and that's determined here about the prop above the floor. Mm-hmm. So this one's at 5. This one I changed to 7, and this one is at 9. So that's how I was able to do that there.
Your staggered heights.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Well, would you mind sharing those handouts for us?
I'm sure. Let's see. And accept. All right. And what I'm going to do is I'll send the whole PowerPoint over, which will there'll be a little bit of redundancy on that. On that Word document. The Word document is like the first half of the PowerPoint, and then combined what I did for my marching band procedures class as the second half of that PowerPoint. But I'll just send the whole thing over.
Perfect. Okay. And we had another comment about props. We do recommend for any props that you plan on moving, we suggest creating those as performer props. You get a lot more flexibility. If you wanted to use a standard prop, we typically suggest those. If you're wanting to do something that's a flat on the ground that you need to be able to see the image for.
Like a floor tarp.
Like a floor tarp, or maybe just a anything that you might be wanting to see on your printout.
And I'm uploading this whole PowerPoint here.
For okay. You can stop your sharing of the screen too, if you'd like. Okay. Were there any questions while we're getting the handouts sent out? Want to remind you that we're also going to have another masterclass tomorrow. It's going to be Jonathan Sweet from Purdue. He's going to be doing some picture shows with us. And also we're going to be doing question and answer on Saturday. So it's an Ask Dustin Anything type day. So here's your chance.
Okay. All right. Well, this has been fun. Hopefully I've been able to give you some information that you'll be able to use, especially if you have a small band. Feel free to contact me. I think my contact information somewhere.
I don't think we have it there, but if you can press share on those handouts, you've only have them saved. Go ahead and press share now.
Okay, sure.
On each of those. There we go. Okay. So we have a PowerPoint. And then do we have another handout as well?
There should have been a, well, the
share on that.
The Word document was pretty much the first half of the handout. So okay. They look at the Word document. They've got the whole PowerPoint presentation. So they'll have all that information.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. Let's see here. We have a question. What is a good transition time between an opener, middle, and closer?
A good transition time? Mm-hmm. As is like between the tunes?
Between the tunes.
I know that I think the death of a show can be waiting too long to go from one tune to the next. I want to say, like, even before the last bit of applause is going, you should be starting the second tune. That's just my opinion. The less dead time, the better. Yeah, obviously you want to make sure that you acknowledge the applause that happens in between. But if you're waiting for somebody to go and change from into their ball gown and put on the tiara and the high heels for the next production, that's probably going to be too long.
Fair enough. let's see, what else do we have here? We have a question. What's the hardest thing to design for small bands?
The hardest thing to design for a small band. Again, I think it depends on the show itself, the type of show you're doing. You know, if you're, I think the hardest thing to do for me for a small band is what I sort of stated earlier about looking at the music. If it's like a repetitive sort of pop tune,
okay,
what can I do to make it interesting? The hardest thing to do, I think, with a small band is try to create something visually when the music is bad.
Oh, fair enough.
I think that's the hardest thing. You know, it's a little bit easier with a larger band because you can have them do like all sorts of crazy stuff. But with a small band, if the music is bad, that's a challenge. That is a real challenge. You know, I've had discussions with some folks like, have you really listened to this? Are you... okay, all right. As long as your check doesn't bounce, I will gladly do this for you if that's what you really want to do. I am your agent. I am your humble servant. That's what you want to do. I'll use an alias or whatever. I don't know.
Fair enough. We had a request about, let's see, wanting to see a refresher on doing a multi-move transition. For an example, a rotating follow the leader. So would you like for me to give that example, or would you like to do that? Or
a rotating follow the leader. A rotating follow the leader. So they're just talking about like combining form.
Right, combined. So I'm going to toss out just a line real quick.
A rotating follow the leader. So a box is rotating and unwinding.
Let's do a follow leader this way.
Okay.
And now, if you're trying to combine or modify a follow leader, you can use the push tool and do a compound to move.
Right.
Okay, so I have my follow leader coming through here, right? So mm-hmm. if I have my compound move, let's say I wanted to kind of shift that up. Okay, so now it's going to keep my follow leader movement. So I'm still doing my follow leader, but it's also being shifted. So Matthew, does that kind of make sense? Is that what you're looking to do? So basically, anything that you have created, you can actually push and adjust. So my follow leader now becomes a little bit modified here. So the compound function in your push tool will give you that type of effect. They also the same thing can be done in your adjuster tool. So if I wanted to just modify a single person, I can do that. And that is going to maintain the pathway it had and just kind of interpolate the path to the new location. As you can see, got my original follow leader here and the few that I've changed.
You know, I didn't talk about the tracking tool that I used to make that pathway for the guard members to go through those alleyways.
So using the track tool, select the form, click on the track. So basically the track is going to maintain the integrity of the form that you have and going to follow the pathway that you decide.
Mm-hmm. And that's what I use to create that pathway to have them come up and around to go through the wind players, if you remember that.
Right. Yes, sir. Were there any other questions on any refreshers that you want to see before we end the session tonight, or any other questions for Brantley or myself? Wonderful. Looks like we're all questioned out currently. Brantley, thank you so much for coming on.
Well, thank you. It's been great. I'm glad to do it. Like I said, I hope I gave some information that someone could use.
Wonderful. What email address would you like to share with everybody?
I'll give my personal email, right? Okay. Which is BTD3, my initials, Brantley Thomas Douglas, and the number 3, BTD3 at MacMAC.com.
Wonderful. Thank you, Brantley. Well,
thank you, Jason.
Wonderful. You have a wonderful evening. Thank you, everybody, for joining us, and we will see you all tomorrow.
Stay safe, everyone. Please stay safe.
Have a great evening. Bye, Brantley.
Bye.